Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Western Staffordshire Bull Terrier Society's introduction to the Staffordshire Bull Terrier. I'm Bryn Cadogan, I'm chairman of the society, and I'd like to introduce our secretary, Mrs. Maureen Broadstock, and our treasurer, Diana Davis. Now, the Staffordshire Bull Terrier is often said to be one of the more difficult breeds to judge and assess. This is mainly said by people that are not really connected with the breed and have had no personal connection of keeping them, owning them, etc. All-rounders tend to find them a little bit difficult at times. They say there are so many types of Staffordshire Bull Terrier in the room today. But basically, there are three types. There are variation in colours and size, but only basically three types. This will be taken into more detail very shortly by our speaker today, who was a founder member of the Western. He served as a committee member, chairman, and is our current president. He has a wealth of knowledge and experience in the breed. He's flown the flag successfully under the Hoplite affix. He's awarded CCs since 1972, which I believe was at Leicester Championship Show. He's someone the club looks up to very much. He guides us, gives us a lot of inspiration, and he, amongst other things, is a true lover of the breed. With any breed standard, interpretation can vary from person to person, from judge to judge. But I believe Alan's interpretation to be as near the mark as possible. Now may I introduce Mr. Alan Mitchell.
My remit today, ladies and gentlemen, is to flesh out the bare bones of a standard with all the oral tradition which has been carried from the very beginning of the breed by the doyens of the breed, and which you don't have access to unless you mix with the Stafford fraternity on a basis of lasting years. Without it, you'll never know what a Stafford person means when they talk about type. Now, at times I shall give you an opinion, and I will state this is my opinion. At other times, I'll talk about facts. And what you must remember is that it is the fact as I interpret it, because there is room for maneuver within close parameters on even the facts about the standard. Now, I must touch on the origin of the breed very briefly. When bull baiting and bear baiting was made unlawful, there was a big upsurge in the interest in dogs, fighting dogs in the pit. No doubt the early people used light bulldogs, but they very soon found out that a cross with a fierce little terrier was much more proficient in the ring than a bulldog. It's stated with great authority in some books that the cross was between the old English terrier, now extinct, and the bulldog. And that sounds quite plausible. But when you think that the people who are mixed up in dogfighting were not people you want for next door neighbours or even living in the next street, I think it totally improbable that they limited themselves to finite breeding between those two breeds. I think any terrier which was successful would have been used. I think that if a bulldog had a night out and the progeny would fight, that progeny would be used. But then came accelerated selection, because if the dog didn't succeed in the ring, it had a brick around its neck and was dropped in the canal. And that cruel selection soon produced a type that succeeded in the ring. The only criterion was success in the ring, and there was one type that succeeded. And very soon, although they varied considerably, you could recognize a pit dog or a bull and terrier. They looked sufficiently alike to be recognisable. Now, one thing came about quite by accident. Those dogs, which were such efficient fighting machines, were also lovers of people and worshipped children. They were totally reliable. They had tremendous character, and people decided that they would register them as a breed. They also were extremely unhappy that Mr. Hinks's cross with an English, with a white English bull, English terrier, and a Dalmatian should have been called bull terrier, when clearly the Staffordshire thing. So they registered them, and the original registration was for a dog between 15 and 18 inches tall, and between 28 and 38 pounds in weight. The bitches were 4 pounds lighter. The standard was revised twice. It was revised by the breeders when they reduced the height from 18-15 down to 16-14 and kept the same weight. Therefore you got a cobbier dog with less height. The Kennel Club then revised it again, brought in gait, and they did it so that they could regularise the standard and make it like all other standards. So we have a dog bred down directly from the pit dog or bull and terrier. Now, if you refer to the standard or stop talking about standard, most people will bring in a dog, go straight to the head. And to my mind, they miss out the most important part of the standard, the first three sections of the standard. And at the moment, I have in the room a male champion and a female champion, and I shall go over these points with them. But first, let me read the first three. General appearance, smooth-coated, well-balanced, of great strength for his size, muscular, active, and agile. Traditionally of indomitable courage and tenacity, highly intelligent and affectionate, especially with children. Temperament, bold, fearless, and totally reliable. So when you're looking at a Stafford, you're looking for a muscular, active dog with strength and agility. The strength is not power strength, it's strength that can be turned into instant action. And the agility is not at the expense of substance, no fragility. And the power has to be carried from the head to the tail. The power in the front must be replicated in the hindquarters. The body must suggest agility. It mustn't be cloppy. The two Staffords coming out are show champions. Therefore, they are extremely good specimens of the breed. The first thing you'll notice is that the bitch is lighter built than the dog, which represents the 4 pounds difference in weight. Now, this does not mean that the bitch has to be weak. The bitch still has to have the same strength. And Nat Cairns in 1960 put it the best way I've ever heard. He said a bitch, by her refinement, should proclaim her femininity. And here you see the difference in the head, the front, and everything else. It's just that touch of refinement. Now, I couldn't put it like that. What I said was, if a head came round the door, you should be able to say with reasonable certainty, there's a bitch coming round the door, or there's a dog coming round the door. And you can see here, I think, exactly what I mean. Now, from the front, you'll see the depth and width of the muzzle give power. You see the way the muzzle deepens and broadens back to the eyes, and then the skull fills out with the cheek muscles, the distinct stop, and the big skull. You'll see the cleft which runs up to the occiput from the eyes, which has pads of muscle either side that allows the dog to express itself. And it works its ears, It lights up its eyes, and it uses this to give expression. From the front, you'll see the brisket, the deep brisket, the broad brisket. You'll see the straight bone, and that means straight, round bone, not cloddy bone. And it doesn't mean the muscles are straight. You'll see some bend because of the musculation of the dog, and you have to be very careful with brindles. You'll also see the distance from the ground to the brisket and the width across. And those are approximately equal, except that because of an optical illusion, if they are equal, they'll always appear to be a little further up this way than across. So here we have two excellent specimens, the round, bold eye. Now, it said muscular, and that means long muscles, athletic muscles, not bold. It said bold, and look at that eye, and either of them, they are bold. They're all about. They look active. Both of those dogs looked as though they would take off in a second and sprint. That's what you're looking for, athleticism. Look at the clean cut shape of them. They look as though they're molded in metal, not put together with clay. The thin lip, the black nose, everything suggests power and agility. Now, to save stress on the two, I'll let the dog go for a moment while I turn the bit sideways and continue the assessment, and the dog will come back for the head study. So if you just turn the bit sideways, you'll see the way the shoulders are laid back. You can see the spring of rib. You can see the way, the shape of the head, the relation of muzzle to skull there. You can see the depth of the stop. And looking at the back, a level back, which just turns down at the croup, which suggests the dog can gather itself under and spring. The forelegs are straight. The shoulders are tight into the body. And the hindquarters are strong, with a well-bent stifle, the hocks well let down, and again, the bulk here matches the bulk there. If there isn't the power behind, the Stafford has nothing. It must balance, and that is essential in the Stafford. This is why I emphasize the first three parts of the Stafford. The tail comes down here, just to the point of the hock, which is about right. And the coat is tight and it's hard. It's smooth, flat and hard that way, and hard, a little bit spiky that way. So here is a typical athletic standard Stafford bitch. Now, I shall go on to the head next, and I'd like the dog out for that. So could we exchange? Head and skull. Short, deep through, with broad skull. Very pronounced cheek muscles. Distinct stop. Short foreface. Nose flat. Now, the head is short when related to other breeds. As you see, it's not a long head. Now, the nose is jet black. And the muzzle, what you're looking for here, is the depth of muzzle. And there's a deep undertone there. The muzzle itself, if you pinch it, you should feel the width of the bone underneath. If the muzzle is fleshy, it can have a fox terrier muzzle on it, disguised by heavy fleshing, and that's foreign to the breed. The stop is almost vertical. It's very deep. There is the cleft I was talking about. You see the setum of the ears, setum of the eyes, and you see that the whole head deepens slightly as it goes back, and the angle of the muzzle to the skull is slightly steeper angle than the muzzle. So here we have a powerful, typical Stafford head. All it says in the standard is the nose is black. Now that doesn't mean dark brown, almost black, and it doesn't mean charcoal grey. It must be black. On a very hot summer's day, occasionally you find a salt deposit on the nose, and you know, you have to make allowances for that. Now, when I saw this for the first time, I thought it was a one-off. But going around the shows now, I see a number of dogs where the nose goes up like a ski jump at the end. And that was never part of the original Stafford. And I think it's only a minor thing, but I think we have to watch this. Now, I have also seen a distinct dip in the muzzle on some dogs. And again, if you look at anything from the BLB books and the original dogs from the beginning right through, that is not as it should be. And I've seen one or two with a hump in the muzzle, a distinct hump. And again, not desirable. If the foreface deepens as it goes back, and that's exaggerated, but if it deepens as it goes back, then you get the correct Stafford head. And sometimes you look at a Stafford's head from the side and you think, what's wrong with that? And in fact, you get the jawline runs straight back, and it doesn't just deepen slightly as it goes back, which gives it a sort of gun dog, handy look, which isn't right on a Stafford. Now, from the top, the broad muzzle, widening gradually, picked up by the skull, is correct. And it's sometimes very flattering to have a pointy muzzle which flatters the head. But the power is lacking there. And what does the standard say? Powerful. And that is not powerful. And it gives the dog a sort of what I call a pixie look. And I really don't like it. That's an opinion. Now, as well as proportions, you have angles on the skull. Now, if the muzzle tips down, Bull Terrier fashion, you've got a down-faced dog, and that is not correct in the standard. If the muzzle tilts upward, boxer-ish, you've got a dish-faced dog. And I know my diagram's not very good, but you're looking at slightly less angle there than there on a Stafford to be correct. Now, originally, the skull was divided into five equal parts. Two from the nose to the stop, and three from the stop to the occiput, which is the little bump at the back of the skull between the two lumps of muscle. Now, the power ratio was good, and with a fighting dog, the side grip was often taken first. With a boxer or a bulldog, they can only take a grip from the front, which is a severe handicap, like a boxer that can only lead a straight left, matching someone who can hook, swing, uppercut, and everything else. So that was considered the correct proportions, and I believe that that applies today. I have had it said to me, you're old-fashioned. You like the longer muzzle. I said, don't like the longer muzzle. I like what, in my opinion, is the correct muzzle. Now, here you see an illustration of 2:3 and 2 is two is the five and two is the three. Two is the four, I beg your pardon. Two is the four. And it does alter the whole shape of the head and the expression. I think if the muzzle is too short, it looks like a Berkshire boar. Now, the stop is a very important part of recognizing a typical Stafford. Now, sometimes the stop rises very slowly and, well, it disappears, and that is foreign to the breed. The correct stop goes up sharply, is quite defined, and is angled just back from the vertical. It's not vertical, it's just back from the vertical. If it's too sloped, it completely changes the appearance of the dog. So, with the head, these are the finer points you're looking for. We come to eyes, and the standard states dark preferred, but may bear some relation to coat colour. Round, of medium size, and set to look straight ahead, eye rims dark. Now, may bear some relation to coat colour. So does that mean that a blue dog could have blue eyes? Well, of course it doesn't. It was introduced into the standard to make some allowance for reds and fawns, which didn't always have as dark an eye as the dark brindles, or indeed the whites. The whites seem to have no problem whatsoever with a dark eye. Now, if you look at the dog, you'll see that it's, of course, the pupils are round. It's the eye sockets which are round. There was a time when you had big protruding eyes. They stood out like organ stumps. Oh yes, they were round. And that gave the dog an apprehensive look, which didn't match the fearless standard. It says the dog should be fearless in trapping. And those eyes look thoroughly wrong. Now, this dog has good eyes. They're dark, and the rims are dark. Now, in white, sometimes you find pink rims, and that's not right. When you have a puppy, sometimes the rims of the eyes on whites are speckled, and often they fill in. But here is a correct eye, and if I may switch the board, that's how I've represented it. Sometimes you get a Chinesey look. The eye socket is almond shaped and slightly up at the corner. And recently I've seen something which I think is even worse, and that is deep fleshy folds under the eye, so you can never see most of the pupils. You can with this one. And the eyes are hidden in deep fleshy folds. And that was never Stafford. That is something which is to be avoided. The fifth section deals with the ears. And we have the bitch on the stage again to illustrate the ears. And once you set up, we'll begin. There you see the ears set on the side of the head, not too high, not too low, and you can see the way the ears fold over neatly to make, there we are, set up. And that is a good ear shape. And when she looks alert, she flicks them slightly forward, and it gives beautiful expression to the dog. The ear is roughly triangular, and you'll see close to the head a crinkle or a pocket in the ear, and then a second fold some distance up, and depending where the second fold is depends the carriage of the ear. The standard says rose or half brick, not large or heavy, and full drop or pricked ears highly undesirable. Now, a lot also depends on the texture of the ear. A good ear is reasonably thin, and at first glance, if you look on the inside of the ear, you suspect that it's lost some hair, because the hair is sparse, it's close, it's small. And the outside of the ear has got the same as on the back, that tight, hard, which will always give you a nice ear carriage. Half prick means that it comes up and tips over to the top, and the rose ear is where it folds over and comes down to cover part of the ear. The fully erect ear was banned. It was present in the breed, but it was bred out, and it does alter the expression significantly. A heavy, hairy ear hangs down, and in the original dog it would have been a desperate disadvantage, despite the fact that they used to crop them. Now, there are variations in carriage, and I have here a normal ear which folds over such a fold, the bulk of the ear is hidden, it's the edge of the fold shows. In some it turns over in a perfectly normal ear, and you can see much of the fold. Now both of those, perfectly correct. And then you come to an ear setting. If the ear is set on too low, that's the impression you get. If the ear is set on too high, you have that impression. If the ear is set too tight in, you'll see that where the ear falls down over the head. Frankly, I don't dislike it, and then you have the ear which is far too wide, sticking out like spitfire wing. And I once had an altercation with a breeder who had that consistently in his stock, and I was not too kind about it, so we fell out about that, I'm afraid. But there we are. That's the ear carriage on the Stafford. The seventh section concerns the mouth of the Stafford, and it says lips tight and clean, jaws strong, teeth large, with a perfect, regular and complete scissor bite. In other words, the upper teeth closely overlapping the lower teeth and set square for the jaw. Now, here, concerning your lip, you'll see that the lip runs back above the bottom jawline, which is correct. The lip is thin and it fits closely to the teeth. The under jaw is deep, so if you get a squarish muscle, and if you look at the fangs, you'll see they're large and they lock the bottom ones over the top one. And if you look at the, shut your mouth, that's it, you see the upper teeth slide just over the bottom. So you have a perfect scissor bite, and the incisors are in a straight line. So here we have a very good bite, a very good mouth, and that is the present ear of perfections you get. And you'll notice I'm dealing with a bitch. Now, with the dog, the strength is very obvious, but there's strength there as well, which is the point I'm making. The breed has been male-orientated, and I think it's wrong. I think bitches are dreadfully important, because the bitches in the beginning were the vehicle to produce the fighting dogs, and they weren't given the attention. You'll notice in the standard they talk about his head, not their head. Anyway, I'm now going to switch over to the analysis. Thanks very much. That's fine. Now, with the underjaw, sometimes you'll find an underjaw which is spoon-shaped, and that's a weak underjaw. A strong underjaw is much more knuckle shape. Obviously that's an exaggeration, but that's what you're looking for, the depth in the muzzle. And there is a deep undertow. Exaggerated? Yes. And there's the spoon shape, weak undertow. Now, judges can be deceived, and they can be deceived where there is a thick and deep lip. The black line here is the jawline. And when the lip comes down below the jawline and goes back, it looks like a square and powerful muscle. And there's one trick to establish it. Put your finger in the where the lips meet and draw it back, and it will reveal that spoon-shaped underjaw clearly. And that's worth doing if you suspect that you've got a lippy dog. A clean lip, you see the lip line here, is above, the red is the lip line, and that is above the bottom jawline as it was in that specimen. And that is what you're looking for. Now with teeth, little pegs are not stackers. They should be big, strong, curved teeth. And the bottom canine should lock firmly over the top canine and slide along it, making a scissor, arguably. And the front incisor should be in a straight line, and they should slide tightly inside the top incisors. Where you have a gap between the bottom incisors and the top ones are outside, you have an overshot mouth, and that is considered in the breed to be bad because the dog finds it very difficult to take a grip. Badly overshot is when the bottom teeth are outside the bottom one, the top ones, and they don't meet them. Sometimes you find two teeth astray, and that we judge according to you. All the teeth in the bottom jaw are inside the top teeth, except two. Now, how you weigh that up as a full, older judges tend to be much more forgiving than younger judges. But it's so important, the teeth and the jaw. There's been a lot of discussion lately about canines which slide inside the jaw or into the gum. I've not seen more than one or two. But if the bottom canines slide inside, that is a deformity and really should be anathema in a breed like the Stafford. Section 8 covers the neck. And the standard says that the neck should be muscular, rather short, clean in outline, gradually widening towards the shoulders. When the neck comes behind a deep, broad skull, it will mold into the shoulders, gradually widening, as they say, but there'll be a big crest of muscle here, which you can feel if you catch hold of the neck. There's a great wadge of muscle there. Now, when the dog is pulled up in the show position, the bottom line of the jaw will not be a long way above the top line. And that will give you the shortness of the neck, but the mobility of the neck, which the Stafford needs. If it's too short, and the chin line, the jawline, comes below the withers, well below the withers, you've got a very stubby neck, and this reduces the agility of the dog. On the other hand, if the neck is far too long, 6 inches up, it looks like a swan's neck, and that isn't Stafford either. The next section deals with the four quarters. And the four quarters are legs are straight and well-boned. They're set rather wide apart, showing no weakness at the pasterns, from which point the feet turn out a little. Shoulders well laid back and no looseness in elbow. If the width of the front is wider than the height from the floor to the brisket, the dog is going to go to ground. If they are equal, The dog is about right. Some people like them a little bit up on the leg. Now, I've drawn these to absolutely for scale. And yet, B looks longer than A. So when you're judging, take that into account when you're looking for the correct height of the dog. The brisket itself, some are very narrow. They come down to a point, and that's not right. I always say, and my opinion is, that if you hold out four fingers, that's about the breadth of the brisket at its lowest point, which is roughly correct. And we come now to the straightness of the front. Now, it's the feet which turn out, not the pasterns. And the one on the far side shows weak pasterns, where the legs turn out at the pasterns. And that is a bad weakness in the staffordshire. Well, the Chippendale front has an actual curve in the bone, and that is wrong. The straight front, the bone is straight, but there will be curvatures in the muscle. You have to look carefully to make sure that the front is actually straight. And brindle sometimes are very deceiving. Now, we come to the body next, and for that I'd like to have a dog with me so that I can point out on the dog. And we'll set up the dog, if you don't mind, broadside on to the audience, with the head facing me, please. I'll have that ready now. Thank you. Now, the shoulders are well laid back. If the shoulders are upright, you will find that the brisket from the front doesn't show very well. It looks like a straight line across. The other thing is, if the shoulders are upright, you get looseness in elbow, and if you catch hold of the head and just rock the stafford, you'll see them flapping like seagull's wings, and that is wrong. If you look at the dog here, you will see that the shoulders are well laid back, shoulders are well tucked in, and that dog is correct. Now, there's a diagram just illustrating exactly what I've said. And when you get an upright shoulder, you always get a little dip in the back. And if you look for the dip in the back, it's down to the upright shoulder. And that is wrong. Now, the next thing in the body, they talk about well-sprung ribs. And if we look at the rib section, if you cut the dog off, unfortunately, right behind the shoulders, with the well-sprung rib, it comes out with the apex slightly above center and then tapers down. If you have the apex of the curve at halfway down, you've got barreled ribs. Barreled ribs will ruin movement, and that's not what's asked for in the standard. Next, you've got two types of backs which have been accepted. The northern back has a dead straight top line, but the tail is set on just below the level of the back. With a Midland dog, you find the back runs back, and just at the croup, there's a little dip, I've exaggerated, and then the tail is set on. Now, I prefer the Midland back, because I always feel that it looks as though the dog can tuck his legs under him and spring. Here, you'll see a perfect back, and again, you see a little dip of the croup, which again is not a rope back. That is a perfectly acceptable back. Now, here I've illustrated the level back, the roach and the dip. Upright shoulders, upright stifles, dip in the back. Then you get the roach back, which again is foreign. And the roach back starts right behind the withers and goes through. You get the level top line, which is level to the croup when there's a slight dip. Now, the next thing is, people confuse short back and short tail. Now, short back is like a French bulldog, and it limits the ability of the dog to turn. Now, short close tail is the distance between the rib and the thigh. And here, you'll see it's about four fingers. And that I consider to be perfect cutting. That is close cutting. The dog, after all, has to turn. And if you see a Stafford playing with a rope or a tire, you see how much it uses that whip, which is provided by that. The next thing is that, again, just if you spread your fingers, you've got a long coupled dog. Now, the next thing is that there is a tuck-up at the loins, and that lends a lot to the Stafford. It makes it look athletic. If there's no tuck-up, like in the English Bull Terrier, it looks slow and ponderous. So there we have the back. And how does it relate to the Stafford? It relates this way. The body, close coupled with level top line, wide front, deep brisket, well-sprung ribs, muscular and well-defined. Now, turning to the, thanks very much. Turning to the hindquarters, very simply, the stifle is well bent. If the stifle comes well bent and the hocks are well let down. And there should be a mass of muscle there, long muscle, well defined, you should be able to see it. When you get an upright stifle, you'll find that the dog will walk like a ship sinking for the bows. The back end will be higher than the shoulders. And that is totally wrong in Staffordshire. And if you judge the dog walking it from the side, you'll see this very, very clearly. People can disguise it when they stand. They can't disguise it when the dog moves. Now, they also say, with the hindquarters, that the legs drop straight down. You have plenty of width, plenty of power, and that is correct. Now, here you've got the cow hop, where the points of the stifle point in. There's a slight turn in. And if you look at the feet of the dog, you'll see the wear on the legs is completely uneven. And finally, you've got the toe in. And there you'll find the dog's legs curve in. And that, again, is not correct. And when the dog moves, it should move with those hind legs moving parallel. The standard says well muscled, hocks well let down, the stifles well bent, legs parallel when viewed from behind. And that sums it up. The feet, very simply, are well padded, strong and of medium size, nails black in solid coloured dots. Now I've never seen a solid coloured Stafford. I've never seen a one coloured Stafford. They've always got either brindling in them or white somewhere. That's not solid colour. I know what they mean. They mean if a dog is pure red or jet black, then they should have black nails. And I can't... My opinion is that dark nails are sufficient. But that's an opinion. Now, the feet are... That's exaggerated. But the feet should be well padded and not long and thin. You find when they're thin, the nail tends to spring out from the foot and curve down so that it touches some distance from. From the front, the toe should be either touching or almost touching. If they're splayed, then that is not a good Stafford foot. So, we come now to the tail. Tail is of medium length, set low, tapering to a point, and carried rather low. Should not curl much. And maybe like an old-fashioned compound. Now then, the tail. With the correct tail, if you pull it out to full length, it usually comes approximately to the point of the hock. Now, sometimes the dog carries its tail up over its back, a game tail. In the old days, they used to say high tail, low courage. I don't know whether it's fact or fancy, but a lot of dogs, when they're wildly excited at a mating or anything else, they will put the tail up. But that's not the ideal carriage. You also occasionally come across a hook tail where the end of the tail is slightly off. A long tail is thought of as being worse than a short tail. because it suggests that bulldog and terrier blood were not the only blood in it. Then you get the ring tail, where the tail actually winds up. And there was one famous champion who had a tail like that and got away with it. The short tail is often pink, and that hasn't stopped some of the dogs getting away with CCs. Dogs have been made up with a short tail. It's never considered as terrible a fault as that is. I'm going to move that gate because I think it would be well to deal with that later. And we come to coat. Coat is smooth, short, and close. And the early Staffords, especially the red, had a coat which was smooth, iron hard, and smooth going that way. Pushing back, you came up and it was spiky. But as long as it's close and flat, we're okay. Size, dogs 28 to 38, bitches 24 to 34, as I've said, 14 to 16 inches at the top of the withers. Now, I don't suppose for a moment there are many dogs picking up CCs now which are actually 38 pounds on 16 inches. There has been some tolerance in this, as there has been tolerance in slightly larger dogs than 16 inches. Now, I'm not particularly concerned about that, as long as the dogs are sound and fit and typical of the breed. The biggest fuss is made when a dog is taller than the standard, and people will actually measure dogs. And I think if they measure them, they should weigh them. Because deviation from the standard can be in weight or in height. And faults, very simply they say, any departure from the standard is considered a fault, and you punish it or you deal with it according to its severity. I say this, when you've looked at a Stafford from the front, from the side, from the back, and looking down on it, you should have assessed its quality and know how good it is according to the standard. And the examination and the fault finding is merely to modify that, to prove that what you saw is what you get. That what you saw was reality. If it is, you know exactly what the dog is worth. Now, after this, we're going on to colour, type, and gait. So this is the end of the standard as far as relating to the dogs and checking on what is typical and what is alien.
Here we have three typical Staffords, which represent the breed. This one will be favoured by people who like a bullier dog. As you see, there's a lot more substance, and it tends to be generally heavier built. Here is a dog, in my opinion, bang on the middle of the road. It's neither bully nor terrier, and they tend also to carry a very nice waistline on them. Finally, you come to the terrier dog, which will find favour with other judges. Here again, you get a good waistline, good tucker, but the whole dog is constructed much more lightly. And dogs of this character do find favour with some judges. And if you ask any of the experts in this room, you'd find practically none of them would agree with me as to where the middle was. Some would say between those two, some would say between those two. But in my opinion, that dog is about middle of the road. Right, thank you. We come to colour, and the standard says red, fawn, white, black, or blue, or any one of these colours with white. Any shade of brindle, or any shade of brindle with white. Black and tan, or liver, highly undesirable. So if you look along the line here, you'll see the contrast between the very dark brindle and the very light brindle, which are very flashy, like bristle, which are very attractive in their own element. That was by far more common in the old days than now when the black brindle takes over. The next dog you have is a blue. And blues have been rare since Bob Salisbury and Graham Steer died, who were determined to breed outstanding blues. But here is one, and a very nice blue indeed. The one on the end of the line not only is there for its colour, but also for its design. This is very much like the Bull and Terriers when they were registered as Staffords. Very light, economical in anything, strong head, but no bigger than necessary to make a target, and built for stamina and for speed. And that shows how the breed has progressed. If you look at that one, and then look at the blue, you'll see just how the breed has moved over the years. Right, thank you. The movement should be free, powerful and agile, with economy of effort, legs moving parallel when viewed from the front or rear, discernible drive from the hind legs. Now here you see the front is moving imperfectly. You'll see when it goes away, you'll see that the hind legs are slightly close. They should be following in exactly in the tracks of the front. There's plenty of drive, plenty of agility. And I'm being nitpicking when I say that. Many muscular dogs do tend to toe in a little.
At this point, it gives me great pleasure to invite up to join Alan Mitchell, our speaker, to form a small panel for a question and answer session. Some of our very special guests today. They're all top championship show judges. They've all bred, exhibited very good dogs, and have played a great part in making the Staffordshire Bull Terrier what it is today. First one I'd like to invite up is Mr. Markham Bowen. As you all know, Markham has the full fin affix and is the owner, or was the owner of the late and great champion Black Tusker, that is behind so many of our pedigrees today. It had a great influence on the breed, also the sire of the famous champion Constance Your Man. The next one to invite up is Mr. George Earle. George has bred a tremendous amount of champions here and abroad over the years under the Judale affix. He judges the breed quite regularly at championship show judges and is still campaigning and showing the breed as it is now. The next one I'd like to ask up is Mr. Trevor Rowe. Trevor, again, is still showing, still very active in breeding and showing in the ring, and has done so for many years under the Rwanda affix. And, of course, Trevor's first dog, coincident as it may seem, was a Hoplite. It was champion Hoplite Red Devil that Alan, our speaker today, bred. Next to come up would be Alan Small, if you would, please. Alan, again, a current exhibitor and breeder, shows very successfully under the Bethane affix and is show manager of the Staffordshire Bull Terrier Club, which is our parent club. Next, Mr. Jim Holmes. Jim, again, showing under the Bells Over affix, is the public relation officer for the Breed Council and is on the liaison council for the breed at Kennel Club. Next, last but not least, is Mr. Jim Parsons. Along with Trevor, they are both founder members of the society as well. Jim is very into other terriers, beside the Staffordshire Bull Terrier, but I know his first love is the Staffordshire Bull Terrier. So there we have our full panel for today.
Thank you.
And the first question comes from Colin Powell from the Parent Club, Bookman's Prefix.
Colin.
Yes, Bryn. What and where is pigmentation in the Staffordshire Bull Terrier? And how oily would you rate it when judging in comparison to other breed points?
Probably George, would you start with that, please?
Yeah. My idea of pigmentation is, firstly, good iron nail colour. Related partially to coat colours, but I still think the Stafford needs to have a good dark eye, regardless of coat colour. Also, we tend to look for Staffords, all colours of Staffords, with black nails. Unfortunately, we don't always find very good pigmentation in the nails, and it does vary, again, from with the colour of the dog to some degree. Colours overall, some people relate to pigmentation, saying that black brindles, which we generally see, have a good eye colour, reasonable nail colour, and again, the spread of the pigmentation throughout the coat is good. In the case of some of the reds, we have the idea that we can accept a lighter eye. I don't really think so. And I often see very, very good dark eyes in reds. Sometimes there's a dilution of the reds, say, into fawns, and they sometimes, again, lose the eye pigmentation to some degree.
So how would you rate it then, George?
Really?
In a scale of points, say, judging against the other breed points, say construction or anything like that, would you?
Well, really, I consider the pigmentation to be mostly cosmetic. Much more important to me is the structure of the dog, the breed type, and the soundness and movement of the animal. Mm-hmm.
Trevor, what are your views on pigmentation?
Well, I feel that there are three or four issues like regarding the pigmentation. Often we find that with the black brindles, the eye may be deeply darkened, but the nail, defective, can be somewhat long. And I feel that, personally speaking, again, when you count the overall balance and overall soundness of the Stafford, irrespective of the Stafford, whatever the breed may be, then soundness takes priority overall every time.
Alan, Alan's wrong?
Yeah, I'll go along with the other two speakers. It is important. You do need good, strong pigmentation, but it's not the be-all and end-all. I mean, type, balance, soundness, would have to be, in advance of pigmentation. If you've got a very sound, a very typical dog with bad pigmentation and a very untypical dog with excellent pigmentation, you'd have to go for the typical dog every time.
Michael, do you go along with that, or would you add anything?
No, I wouldn't like to add much more to it. I think all the speakers have spoken, they've got it quite right. First and basic law, if you haven't got a sound breed type or if you haven't got a sound dog, you're going nowhere in any case, and it is, as one of George commented on, it's basically cosmetic, but it is a bit off-putting if you've got a dog with very bad pigment in his eye and he's a black brindle or something like that. It will give an overall good picture of the dog, but if that's what you're going to look for when you're judging the dog, I'm afraid you're going to finish up with just a load of mediocre dogs in the breed, because when you're judging a dog, I always think you start at the nose and you finish up at the tip of the tail. And you judge the dog as a whole, and the whole being greater than the part.
So really you're saying it's the strength of the competition?
It's got to be the strength of the competition. A judge can only judge what's put in front of him on that day. And he's got to take all these points into consideration. But I can only repeat what Alan said. If I've got two dogs of equal merit in front of me, and one has got good pigmentation and the other haven't, obviously the one with the bad pigmentation would have to stand second. But I mean, you just can't disregard the dog just for one fault. You're just going to finish up with a breed of mediocre dogs.
Is there anybody else that would like to comment further on that? And yes, Jim.
Yeah, I'd just like to join in. Of course, the ideal is what the standard says, and the standard says quite clearly, dark eye. I don't think personally that we should take any second choice from that. We should all be trying to achieve and to trying to breed a dog with a dark eye, dark nails and good pigmentation. That's what the ideal should be. But of course we all have to settle sometimes for a little bit less than ideal. The only worry that I would have, if we start to, or if judges start to accept and to put up dogs with bad pigmentation, such as light eyes, light nails, then how long is it before they start getting light noses? And don't forget, we want a black nose. And black nose comes from pigmentation. Now if you start to let your pigmentation start to deteriorate through your nails, through your eye colour, then how long is it before it starts to go into your nose? And we certainly don't want to get there, so we've got to be watchful all the time, and you've got to breed for the ideal. And if you're breeding for the ideal, that is the dark eye, the dark nails. In fact, if you look in the roof of a mouth of a good pigmented dog, you'll find that the roof of his mouth is black. Now, that's what we've got to try to achieve. And we've always got to be trying to, whatever point it is that you're breeding for, you've got to be trying to breed the best you possibly can. So you, with regards to judging, if you're judging, of course, pigmentation, same as some people would say, ear carriage. Some people would say tail carriage is cosmetic. It is not as important as a constructional point. Construction must come first. If you've got a dog with perfect pigmentation, perfect ear carriage, and perfect tail carriage, where he's calloped, or he's out at front, he's weak in pastens, then those faults must be more serious than his cosmetic faults.
Right, well, what and where is pigmentation? Jim, could you just finish this one off for us and just give us a few?
Yeah, well, pigmentation, if you take the standard as pigmentation, the only mention in the standard where pigment is mentioned, but not actually as pigment but as colour, is in the nose, the eyes and the nail colour. It's never mentioned as pigmentation in coat colour, and a lot of people interpret pigmentation as being coat colour. And you can't have a bad coloured dog unless it's a colour which is debarred. The pigmentation must be kept to the eyes, the nose and the tail. And the eyes, the nose and the nails.
The tail and the
toenails. Toenails.
Right, thank you, Jim. We'll move on to the next question now then, and it comes from Martin Grimwood of the Storm Star Papers. Martin, please, your question.
There seems to be a number of poor top lines at the present, especially on the move. Do you feel this is down to breed specialists not feeling profile movement as much as all around us?
Right. Should we start with Alan?
The top line of a dog is often dictated by the shoulders. If the shoulders are upright, you'll definitely get a dip in the back. If the hindquarters, they've got very straight stifles, again, you'll get a very poor top line. And when the dog is moving, if you look at it from the side, it looks like a ship going down by the head. The backside is higher than the shoulder. The other fault you get is roaching. Now occasionally, if a dog is a bit tense in the ring, it will roach its back a little. So wait till it moves, look at it sideways. If the back straightens out, it's a good one. Don't mistake the little dip at the croup in a Stafford for bad top line. The top line is level. There should be a pad of muscles either side of the spine. You could put a dinner plate on and it would stay there. A big flat back running by, and then the little dip at the croup. And that to me is top line.
But do you think that breed judges watch more fore and aft rather than in profile movement than an all rounder? Jim, what do you think on that point?
Well, that's a bit difficult because I suppose I judge more other breeds than anybody else sat here, and or maybe Alan, but and yourself. But the thing is, I always walk to the side to see them go up and down the second time. They put them down once, and I go to the side and watch them go up and down.
But do you think the breed is suffering because breed judges are not taking enough notice of that? We know what you do. Yeah. Do you think the breed is suffering top line wise because breed specialists do not take enough notice of this. I just want a yes or no.
Well, possibly yes, it's because they don't take it into consideration and go up to the see the government on the site.
Margaret Wall,
yep. Well, if a dog's built right and it's constructed right, he'll move right. And he'll carry this carrier's level top line, but if you've got a dog that, you know, you can see some now, and I won't name dog, you can stand at the ringside. The best way to look at some dogs sometimes, if you've got a good top line, is when they stand in slack, not when the handler's stacking him. You can make a dog stack, you can stack a dog any time, but you can't stack him when he's on the move. And I've always found that, look at some of these dogs, and some of them are a lot higher at the back end than they are at the front, and there's no way, I don't care whether you move up and down, sideways or upside down, when he'll move, he won't have a top line because his back end's the block, that's the same as Alan said, he's tipping him into the front all the while. Because if he's not constructed right on the back end, he didn't win a move.
Do you feel we should take more profile movement as well?
Well, you've got to take the same as I've just said before in the previous question, you've got to take the dog as a whole. Now, it's all right, the dog can be a bit stronger, leveler in top line, a good dog. Probably got an excellent front, he's got a beautiful head, but when you start going to the back of him, he's not so good in that department, but you've got to weigh all things up, and the only thing you can do is decide between those individual dogs there in the middle of the ring at the time you're judging them. You can only go on that, you can't go on, you know, everybody wants a perfect dog. But I'm afraid, as always found out, and I think a lot of these panelists have been batting on this, if the dog's built right, he'll move right. And don't forget, it's not many years since we've only had this movement clause put in the standard. As regards movement.
Right, Alan Small. Anything to say on that?
Yeah.
Do you feel that breed judges have taken enough notice of the movement in profile? That was mainly the question.
Yeah, I think everybody's gone around the ranking to the point. The answer to that is, I think they probably do. They all round the moves them more in a triangle. And in many terrier breeds, they move them round the ring a couple of times where they're assessing side movement, where you can see a top line. We tend not to do this in Staffords, and we do move them up and down. And perhaps the more experienced judges will check the top line, but on some of your junior judges, maybe they don't go and look at the top line as much as perhaps they should do. But I must agree, I think all rounders tend generally to go more into movement, not knowing type, they will go more into movement of a dog and the way it moves around the ring. And at that point, I must say that I think they do. I pay more attention to that point from the breed specialist.
Trevor, have you got anything to add to
that? Yes, I have indeed. I feel that when we talk in terms of the top line and the judges, their judging and their various views on the movement and so on, I think this is a very, very important factor. I think it's one of the most important factors of all, because what we're coming back to is, like you've already heard Mr. Mitchell, when he mentioned about the shoulder placement, and likewise the back end, the dog is stilted in makeup, then he would be carrying the back end eye on the move. And so it all sounds like a top, what we're talking of the top line, but basically what we're talking about, it all boils down to the soundness. And I feel that if the top line is out like that, then that animal is not sound. And speaking as a breeder, I feel that one should then trace back to where these elements have arisen from and to avoid such breeding, because as it's already been stated, and I reiterate this remark, if a dog is made right, he'll move right, and obviously if he's not moving right, he's certainly not worth breeding from, it's not sound.
So do you think that enough profile movement is taken into consideration?
I think possibly a lot of the top judges are too complacent over this matter, and I think it should be gone into deeper depths on the movement, there's definitely.
Thank you, Trevor. Jim, anything to add to that?
Well, yeah, quite a bit, really. One thing is, of course, what Alan was saying is quite right. I mean, the more angulated, not only the front end, you've got to get the back end right. If you can get the front shoulders into roughly around about 45 degrees layback, and you can get the angulation of the pelvic bone about 30 degrees in angulation, then of course it's bringing you nicely together. As soon as you pull the shoulders back, the scapula back, of course, when you do that, you move the base of the neck back. so it gives you that nice flow through into the withers, pulls the withers back, and it takes that dip out from at the back. The thing about the all-round judge and the specialist judge, I can also remember listening to a conversation many years ago, which probably, as far as I'm concerned, the top all-round judge I've ever seen in my life was a man called Leo C. Wilson. And he once was commenting to some specialist judges, and he said to them, because they were criticising him for that he'd not picked up on certain specialist points when he was judging, and he said, listen, once an all-rounder thinks he's a specialist judge and starts trying to judge like a specialist judge, all he becomes is a second-class specialist judge. And when a specialist judge starts to judge like an all-rounder, or thinks he's an all-rounder, then all he becomes is a second-rate all-rounder. So I would say leave the specialist judge to do their job, which is to look after the specialist points that we've got in the breed, and the all-rounders to look after their job, which is to look at the type where we're going, movement, soundness and that. But until we start getting shoulder placements, and certainly back end, because the back end is just as important as the front, until we start getting that angulation and the soundness and some bender stipple, until we start getting that right, I don't think we're going to get the top line going.
But don't you feel then we need a happy medium of specialist as opposed to all-rounder judges to keep this happy balance?
Personally, I would answer that by saying this: we need good specialist judges and we need good all-rounders, not people who are coming into judge staffies from outside of the breed purely and simply to get the CCs under the hat to go forward through to doing groups and things like that. Good judges we can always accept. The breed can always accept good judges. We've had them in the past. I mean, I think my colleague would say, the people that knew him and can remember him, the men like the OC were world famous. They were giants in dogs. I mean, we can always welcome those sorts of men into our breed to help us. I mean, Terry men. I mean, I don't know. Albert Langley.
Right, George, have you got anything to add to that?
So we're thinking back. I think that the specialist judges nowadays definitely look at the dogs much more in profile than they did, say, 25 or 30 years ago. That's my opinion, and therefore I don't think that they ignore the top line in profile at all.
They don't. So they probably penalise it within depending on what you've got there to do. You can only judge what's before you.
Exactly.
Right, thank you.
Gay high set tails seem to be quite common in some winning dogs. Do you consider it to be a minor fault when the breed standard calls for low set tails?
Yes, I think it is a major fault. But what are we talking about? Are we referring to like a dog that shows up at a sparkle when he meets another Stafford? Are we talking about that? Or are we talking about something that's in the structure of the dog? Again, we're not too far away from the last question, in my opinion. I feel that if it's structurally wrong, if a dog is made structurally wrong and is set on the tail, then I feel we're back into the same situation. You've got an unsound dog. But it could well be that, which is a case and always has been with our breed, in many instances, it's just that the dog is showing a lot of sparkle. That's the case. But it goes hand in glove with his nature.
Yeah,
but if it's not, and if it's a structural thing, then that should be penalised as such.
The question, Trevor, was a high set tail. So if it's high set, as opposed to the breed standard calling for a low set tail. So it is in your mind then, a fault that should be treated
as... That is right. The high set, following through from the question in that case, then I would say that it should be set low. Should be set down low and not on top of the back.
Malcolm, anything on tails?
Yeah, it is. I mean, the standard regard a low set tail, and according to the standard, when he's carrying his tail, should be marked into a full bundle. But any dog worth his salt, if he gets in a ring and he gets excited, whether it's low set or not, that tail's going to come up here. I've been watching the dogs you had over here today. Carrying the tail to the standard, they got the low set tail, and they've got the correct full bundle. As soon as they watch it, that starts coming up. Now, I'm not on about the R set tail, when the dog's up, and you can't ignore it when the tail goes right over the back. from the dog, well then that is bad. It can distract from the dog's movement. But having said that, when they used to have the scales points in the years ago, they got 5 points for the tail. And if the rest of the dog was constructively sound, and the right constructively sound, 95 out of 100 ain't bad, isn't it?
It's
a problem, but everything's got to be considered depending on. Here again, and I can only reiterate what I said before, is you can only use the dogs as they appear on that day. I don't like a dog with a dead tail. I don't like a dog with a lot of things, but you're never going to have the perfect dog. And what you're going to do is, and while I'm talking, I'll just give you one bit of advice from me, is when you do find the perfect dog, you manage to breed him, I should shoot him, have him stuffed, and then start to you know where else to go.
We're
all looking for that. You're never going to get the perfect dog. You've already got what you've got.
Anybody else
like
to comment on tails?
Yeah, I concur with the others. My feeling is that the going back to the point standard where there were 5 points for tails, okay, we don't like to see them with gay tails, but there are many more things much more important that we should be looking for than putting a particular emphasis on them carrying the tails off a bit. I'm not saying that high set tails are right, but far from it. The tail should be low set and the dog should carry it low. But when the dog may be excited, then it's natural to put it up, and there's nothing wrong with that.
And they do tend to show themselves off better, don't they, when they are in that pose. Yes.
If any of you use your dog at stud, you may have a dog that's never had a tail in his life, but when he sees the bitch come in for mating, up goes the tail, and that's almost a natural thing. In the ring, if a dog's provoked, it may put its tail up, and as long as the structure's right, I wouldn't be too worried about it.
But then again, the question is the set of the tail.
Oh yes, that's what I say, if the set is wrong.
I mean, any
different question. But don't be confused by a dog that's suddenly whoopee and that goes the tail.
Look for the set of it.
That's it.
Rather than the carriage. Anybody else like to comment on tails before we go on to the next question?
Just to confirm that, of course, when we're talking about the high and low set on, we're talking about the place that it is set on the spine. But if it's set right up there on the top, right at the end, like a white box area or a small dog, then that is a high set on. Where it falls down a little bit and the tail is stuck on there and it's sort of that, then that is a low set on. So don't confuse it between how high or how low it carries or
its tail. Except
that a dog with a high set on will tend to carry his tail higher. That's why they're all wires and smooths and things like that. They have to be carrying the tails. The only one point I would add to the point system that Malky mentioned, of course, is that you've got 5 points for a tail, but you've got 1 point for having a tail. So in actual fact, you only lost 4 points if you had a gay tail.
This question comes from Rosemary Key, who is a life member of the Western Society and the owner of the Roski Apex. Thank you, Rosemary.
What's the panel's opinion on the present discussion concerning the so-called inverted canines, and also how serious and prevalent do they think it is in the breed at the moment?
Right, let's start out with Jim.
Well, one of the problems with inverted canines, if they are badly inverted, they cause discomfort to the dog because they go up into the roof of the mouth. Because they go inside, they don't mesh in a normal way, they go up, and you will find if you open the dog's mouth, you'll find little ulcerated points where they're going up. You will see in the ring, if you're judging, dogs often where they've lost their bottom canine, or they've snapped off, or Malcolm's laughing, he knows that, we talk about this, they've either snapped off or they've been cut off. It is a problem, and the problem I think started with people trying to breed for less undershot mouth by getting a smaller jaw, bottom jaw, and because of this then the smaller jaw, teeth go closer together and the canines then go up inside. And I think it is a problem, but it's not a problem we can't get over.
So So you don't think it's too serious at the moment, do you?
No.
As you judge recently, do you think there are a number in the breed? Or?
I found about four. I found about four at our championship show 3 weeks ago.
Right, Trevor, what do you feel on this subject? Because I'm saying this because you judged recently as well. Did you find it a problem that was rife in the breed that you judged?
I wouldn't say rife, but I've obviously encountered a few inverted canines because there are a few in our breed. But having said that, I think it's all depend on the judge and the breeder and they view this situation. But personally speaking, I view it from the angle that it's just another problem that we in the breed or breeders have to surmount, in as much that irrespective of what the problem is, that one has to go about it quite calmly and collectively, if you will. And especially so, like from the breeding angle, I would advise that if one feels, oh, that's where that problem has stemmed from, then the obvious thing to do is to make doubly sure that in one's breeding that you don't double bank or any such thing as that. So then you're only doubling up on a problem. And whether it's inverted canines or what else, I feel that if everybody goes about their breeding program with that sort of attitude, irrespective of what the problem may be, whether it's inverted canines or otherwise, then I don't see it as any great problem, no more than what can be encountered. The same as we have in the breed in the past.
I thank you, Trevor. George, how do you feel about the kind of canine?
I think we read a lot about it at the moment, but I've certainly not come across any great number. Nothing really to be perturbed about. I don't think it's any greater problem than, say, something like small teeth. In fact, I've probably seen many more small teeth when I'm judging than inverted canines. So I think we're blowing the thing about really out of all proportion. And I'm wondering if maybe in the last few years, perhaps the change of types of diets that dogs are fed on might have something to do with this. Mm-hmm. You know, should they be getting perhaps more hard feed, perhaps having more bones or whatever when they're young dogs? It's very difficult to say because I don't know of any work that's been done to prove one way or the other, but I think something like that could well influence it.
Thank you, George. Alan Small, what's your feeling?
Well, inverted canines itself is a very serious one. I mean, obviously, if they are inverted, it means that their teeth are actually going into the roof of the dog's mouth, which means you can't bite correctly, it's damaging yourself, and it's a fault that you don't want. Now, the degree that it's in Staffords, from what I've seen over the past few years, it's not as widespread as perhaps in some other breeds, and I don't think it's really a serious problem in our breed, although it is a serious fault if you've got it. A dog can achieve that unfortunate sort of problem of inverted canines by an hereditary problem, which then if it's got that and it's passed on to its mother or father or its previous generations, there is a serious problem with the breeding of that line. And you've got to be careful, as the other gentleman out there said, about doubling up on that fault. You can get inverted canines also by what George was saying, diet. And I think he means, when he says diet, he doesn't mean diet of an adult dog. He means diet in a puppy. Now, I'm assuming this, because one of the things that can give you inverted canines is when the small baby canines are not released correctly at the time when they're bringing in the other teeth. And you end up with like a double bank of canine. You get a baby canine on the outside and your full canine, your new canine coming in on the inside of the of your small teeth. And that forces the inverted, the canine, the proper canine, into a vertical position, which is incorrect because there should be an angle to the jaw. With a canine at a vertical position, it then assumes what we call an inverted canine and it penetrates the roof of the mouth. And perhaps with bones a little earlier, as George suggested, or a harder tack move or harder biscuit, or perhaps it should work the baby canines,
to mag them loose or then to release a bit earlier.
So Alan, you think it is a serious problem when you've got it, but it's not
I don't think it's a serious problem in our breed. There are one or two animals with it. The fork itself is serious, but it is not serious in our breed, in my opinion.
Anybody else would like to comment on that?
Yeah, I've been to one or two places. I was in New Zealand and Australia at the back end of last year. I've been to South Africa this year. I'm also just in England. And in some places where I've been, they seem a little bit paranoid about this. I think it's what they call the flavour of the month, mm-hmm. or what we're judging about. You know, this is the thing now that everybody's talking about, these inverted canines. I must admit, I mean, I got told before I went to one certain country, oh, they've all got inverted canines there. I suppose, and I must admit, the dogs I saw there, probably a couple of three of the dogs. But, you know, I was told, some person, Carl, informed me to say, well, I said, well, I'll see what I want to see when I go. And I found probably about a couple of three. It is a problem. It is a problem, but I don't think it's a big problem. It's one of the other things. It's the same as eyes. This eye problem we've got, the same as anything else. All right, we've got to watch it. And I do think, sometimes, it can be caused by, you know, the puppy having a lot of trouble casting his puppy teeth, for one thing, and there's some people say you should have them removed as soon as you can, let the vet take them out as soon as you can to give it proper room for that thing to move. And others say, you know, you just have to take his chance. Other people say it's like not giving him something to pull on with the bones, but I think it's a problem, but I don't think it's as severe as some people make it out. And I think it's, you know, just people, some people get a little bit paranoid about one fault, same as they got on about it displacing, same as they got paranoid about ours. These things are going to be with us, they'll probably come, and they'll come out. But why, it's really said, it's probably because so many people talking about it at this moment. But I can only say, and I can only answer for the dogs that I've judged in these three or four countries abroad that I've been to, and they've got one or two, they've got no more than we've got here. But I don't think it's so prevalent as a lot of people seem to make it out. But obviously it's appalling, I must agree. It can't be any good for the dog or the breed, but for that canines going in and damaging your roof. Just like you having something passing in your mouth, isn't it? Or something sticking in there. Not good.
Thank you, Malcolm. And Alan, would you like to have the last word on that? Because that's the last question of the day.
Right, but we can finish off with us. Well, I'd like to talk about the surrounding thing. We've been talking about faults. And everybody here, I think, all these judges, these experienced judges, are not fault judges. And that's the thing to avoid. Judge the qualities, and then adapt your decision on the extent of the fault you find. So, you know, judge each fault on its merits. But for goodness sake, as everyone here has said, judge the whole dog, the Stafford, the active, muscular, athletic, strong Stafford with a bold expression and good temperament. And temperament means all. If temperament goes wrong, there'll be 19,000 Staffords muzzled or castrated. So get the temperament right. And that's really not anything to do with the question, but I had to say it.
On that note, I'd like to thank the panel for coming today, giving us their expertise. Could I have a round of applause?